Hello, friend. Audiotapes. Everybody loves audiotapes. Today, I wanted to talk about hard surface fundamentals and modeling simple but nevertheless awesome asset like this very audiotape. This is a very iconic information carrier from the past that everybody loves, and we will talk about the process of its creation from start to finish. In this video, we'll be discussing the stages of blocking the model out, how to look at the reference, how to replicate the model one-to-one to its real object. We will also mention UV mapping and making ID maps to texture the object more conveniently. I will also talk about baking the surface details or micro details and how to create the final asset while maintaining production quality topology of your model. So, without further hesitation, let's jump into the viewport. Hey, before we start, consider subscribing to my channel and let me know that you liked videos devoted to hard surface modeling in the comment section. I will be increasing the scope of these videos and talk about more complicated subjects. Also, there are many more videos to come that you hopefully will enjoy. Thank you for being here and let's continue by looking at our reference model. Before going forward with modeling straight away, it's a good practice to look at the reference of your object. Let's look at the reference photo of this audio tape that we're about to model. Of course, an audio tape has a very simple rectangular shape, and one might not even bother looking at the reference. But nevertheless, analysis of the reference before modeling is a very good practice and crucial for modeling any object that we want to replicate one-to-one. This audio tape can be separated into the following shape groups depending on its levels of detail. First one will be primary shape, and will include only the general, biggest shape of the object. In our case, it is this huge rectangular shape. Second one will be secondary shape. Those are second biggest shapes that give an object a recognizable form. Third one will be tertiary shape. Those are small shapes, holes, details that help emphasize the overall shape of the object. And if we look at other hard surface objects, those are the small shapes that serve certain utilitarian function. These can be holes for screws, little handles, and so on. And the last shape group that may or may not be there is surface details. Those are the smallest visible surface elements that give the object a certain distinguishable texture. In the case of our audio tape, those are small rectangular, waffle-like extrusions that we're going to model separately, because keeping details like that will make our model too poly-heavy. So, let's proceed with the next stage, the stage of blocking out the primary shape of the model. I just start with a simple cube and shape it into the rectangular form, and then bevel the corners so that it would represent the main primary shape of an object recognizable from afar. Then I start extruding some secondary shapes that form the main shape of an object. I added cylinders and used booleans to cut out other secondary shapes, like two holes in the center of the audio tape. I add some geometrical density to the model by cutting some more edge loops, so that the boolean cuts could not create some weird topological edges and shading. At this stage, I'm keeping everything fairly low poly. After that, I also extrude another secondary shape, which is this square hole in the middle used for glass elements. Then I boolean the holes out in the bottom of the audio tape exactly as they are on the reference model. I go a little bit ahead of myself and also extrude little notches on the side of the audio tape. But these notches are super simple and didn't break the topological flow, so I was okay. Then I have cut out another secondary shape in the middle of our audio tape. The one that is extruded downwards and serves as a little support notch for an audio tape's label. Afterwards, I boolean out other holes in the bottom part of the model. Shortly after, I have created the rolling mechanisms of our audio tape. I kept them quite low poly, and using knife tool and join vertices, I have made sure that there are no topological problems on that element and it subdivides correctly. Moving on forward, I boolean little tertiary details like holes for the screws near the corners of our model that emphasize its overall square-like shape and make it look better, to be honest. They add additional layer of detail, not mentioning the screws were in the reference photo of the audio tape. Also, it should be mentioned that the smaller the cylindrical element used for boolean operations, the less vertices count of the cylinder you should set, so that the topology would be more manageable afterwards. Shortly after cutting those elements, I have started making screws. I have beveled a low poly cylinder, then used two squares to boolean the notches on the screws. Then, what I do is clean up edge flow on one side of the model and mirror it, so that I would have ideal symmetrical element with proper subdividable topology. Then I create a plane and make a mesh for the label texture, and after that I used another simple plane object, scaled it down to make the film stripe at the bottom of the audio tape. After that, I assign quick materials and look at the model. And basically, at this stage, I already had a fairly low poly and recognizable model, and if you're making a game model, this should be already enough. You can make a little cleanup of the topology, save up the model, proceed to making UVs and bake any details you want and texture the model. But I wanted a prop for close-up renders, so I wanted to make sure it will be working well when subdivided and have decent topology with no issues. And that meant a lot of cleaning up. What I also notice is that a lot of modelers avoid the process of cleaning up the topology of their models, or it's just something that they're not capable of doing because they're not creating sub-D models. But when you want perfect results and the object will be right in front of your camera, geometry better be clean and dandy. So, as you can see, the process of cleaning up is quite a tedious one. It involves looking at the model, removing some of the problematic n-gons, constantly checking the wireframe of your model in subdivided state and unsubdivided state. But I think final results? Worth the effort. Also, what should be noted is that you shouldn't be getting rid of absolutely all n-gons in your models, only the ones that cause issues after subdividing the model. Here's the thing you should remember. The subdivision modifier will turn all the faces of your model into quads, so you don't have to worry about that too much. The secret of proper subdivision modeling is in keeping your initial model fairly low poly, especially your bevels, cylindrical shapes, and other curvature. When I was okay with the topology of my model and the way it subdivides with no issues, I have modeled surface details by simply using a plane, beveling its vertices and extruding it out, and then using a ray modifier. I've basically created a huge amount of little rectangular shapes that would cover the front of my model. Then I used Boolean modifier to shape them the way I wanted to. All these little details I have created as a result were vital for me during the baking process. Alternatively, you can do the same thing in a texturing software without baking anything, but I wanted to have direct control over the geometry I had in my viewport. Besides, when you're baking such surface details, you usually end up with a nice ambient occlusion and curvature maps that will be very useful when you procedurally generate effects in Substance Painter, but we'll talk about that a little bit later. After that, I have made some finishing touches on the rest of the elements, added some extrusions on the audio tape roll, made corrections where necessary, tweaked materials, and previewed my model in the viewport. When all the modeling stages were finished and I had all the elements that could be baked to the low poly version of the model, I've started the process of unwrapping the audio tape. It's a fairly straightforward process. I just manually mark all the sharp angles of my model, press unwrap, look at the texel density by using a simple checker's texture, make some corrections along the way. I have also used camera projection for the front and the back side of my model. After finishing my UV textures, I've quickly made a color ID map, basically by just filling different elements of the model that will have different materials with different colors. This is done so that I could mask these elements out in Substance Painter. Finally, I have repositioned my model so that it would be baked properly and exported it over to Substance Painter, where I baked my high poly version of the model with surface details to a low poly version of the model. Then, after baking everything and making sure that there are no artifacts and UVs are fine, I have proceeded to texturing. During the texturing process, I rarely use painting tools. In the first stages of texturing, I use substances generators to emphasize curvature of the objects. Then I use dirt generators to create the effects of dirt scratches. As for the label of the audio tape, I have used Photoshop and quickly created my color map for the label there, and then sent it back to Substance Painter, where I have added some roughness effects, scratches, and dirt. Texturing is a very creative and enjoyable part of the process. Basically, the model that you have worked on comes to life at this stage, and I just love it. Overall, I have made several versions of the audio tape. The pristine one with no scratches and several dirty ones. After that, I have set up my texture export settings to comply with Cycle's requirements and exported my textures back to Blender, where I have created quick pre-renders of my model. So that's basically it. This is how this audio tape was made step by step. I hope you find this workflow video useful. I usually like watching videos like that without strict basic instructions, because every model and every project is different and there are no set rules of creating something. And what matters in my opinion is the way you approach a creative task you have at hand and solve it. Also, looking at this asset after I've already finished it, I think I could have made it less dense. I probably should have used bevels with less edge divisions and it would have worked anyways. But I wasn't thinking about poly count during my modeling flow really, as all I cared about is nice render images. At the end of the day, I ended up with a mid to low poly model with decent enough topology and good textures. I also made a quick optimized version of it by removing some edges here and there, and the model remained the same, and it's feasible to use in-game engines. Thank you for watching this video, hope you liked it, and I wanted to remind you to subscribe as more content will be uploaded to this channel soon related to both hard surface and organic modeling, rigging, rendering, and animation. By the way, if you want to buy this model, you can do that too. I'll post the link in the description of the video down below. Have a great day. Bye.